Three interesting presentations. The first will be by Arthur Nusbaum. Arthur Nusbaum is the founder and curator of Third Mind Books. So maybe some of you will have seen the catalog, which is available there. You can also pick up his card. Third Mind Books is located in Ann Arbor, Michigan. He's an independent scholar with a special interest in William Burroughs. The title of his paper was changed a little bit in the course of time. It is now Beat Books as Artifacts, Exploring with James Grauerholz in Burroughsland. Although I think Arthur pronounces it slightly differently. I think you say Grauerholz. Grauerholz. So okay, I've heard the two pronunciations both today. Let's stick to Grauerholz, because you've heard him yourself. So from now on, we know that it's Grauerholz. I'm sure he will be able. He was in Middleburg too. I'm not quite sure whether you were being filmed then.
Yes.
You were being filmed then also. And you came up with some quite amazing surprises. You also always have interesting documents and goodies. So please, Arthur, go ahead.
Thank you. Good afternoon. It's a great pleasure to be attending this important conference again this year. It's been a true delight listening to the talk so far. And thank you, Bent, wherever you are. Ah, there you are.
Okay,
for putting together such a wonderful event. I am pleased to present to you a further exploration of the life and work of William S. Burroughs. But before I begin, I must briefly draw your attention to two matters. First, this presentation is dedicated to the memory of Carl Port, who lost a valiant battle with cancer and passed away on July 10th. Carl was my mentor, collaborator, and assistant in my bookselling and independent scholarly endeavors. Most of all, he was my good friend. Many of you met him at the first EBSN conference last year. He was a world-renowned bookseller, publisher, journalist, educator, and humanitarian. He was especially beloved in my hometown of Ann Arbor, Michigan, where he was a bridge between the University of Michigan and the larger intellectual and literary community. In recognition of his work, a prestigious chair at the university was named in his honor. His passing is a great personal loss to me and many others, but his legacy will most certainly live on. Second, I need to make a small correction to the presentation I made at last year's inaugural EBSN conference. As some of you may recall, I compared this short note, purportedly sent by Burroughs to Gregory Corso, with Burroughs's 1959 ink drawings. I believed I perceived a stylistic echo between them and made a few corresponding observations. After returning home from the conference, I got in touch with James Grauerholz. As many of you may know, Grauerholz was the longtime companion of Burroughs, who also made Grauerholz his adopted son. Today, he is the executor of the Burroughs estate and the head of Burroughs Communications in Lawrence, Kansas. At any rate, I decided to send Grauerholz the images and text of the presentation for his information. Among all the images of otherwise authentic artifacts, he immediately seized on the note as a fake, and he ultimately provided me with a formal analysis of it. Thus began an intriguing correspondence between us. Our exchanges made me more aware than ever of his encyclopedic knowledge of Burroughs's life and work. It made me want to explore this with him in depth. I asked Grauerholz if he would be amenable to getting together to talk about the context of certain items in my collection, and he agreed without hesitation. So, as it turns out, my little fumble was a port of entry into the heart and soul of Burroughsland. So off I went this past June to Lawrence, Kansas, Burroughs's last residence, and home, as I said, to Burroughs Communications, where Grauerholz guards and nurtures Burroughs' legacy as its foremost authority, assisted by his trusted lieutenants. From among my sizable trove of Burroughsian artifacts, I chose to bring with me two items to serve as the launching point for an exploration with Grauerholz in Burroughsland. First, this document, Report of the death of an American citizen with cover letter, dated September 24th, 1951. It was sent to Burroughs in the immediate wake of the accidental shooting death of his wife, Joan Vollmer Burroughs, by his own hand in Mexico City on September 6th, 1951. This incident has been extensively depicted and analyzed, most insightfully by Dr. Oliver Harris, as well as by Grauerholz himself. In the third chapter of his critical study, William Burroughs and the Secret of Fascination, and in his introduction to the new edition of Queer, which he edited, Dr. Harris focuses on Burroughs's assertion that, quote, "I am forced to the appalling conclusion that I would never have become a writer but for Joan's death," unquote. According to Burroughs, he essentially had to write his way out of the threat of being possessed by the ugly spirit that caused the accident. It's my understanding that he, Dr. Harris, concludes that Burroughs draws attention to the episode in order to distract the reader from the actual content of Queer, quote, "so that the instant of the fatal shot elides the text out of existence," unquote. In his lengthy, intensely researched essay, The Death of Joan Vollmer Burroughs, What Really Happened?, Grauerholz brings together all the facts that he was able to verify, along with all the eyewitness and hearsay accounts he was able to gather, as if Burroughs were being retried Rashomon style. He then leaves it up to the reader to draw his or her own conclusions as to what happened and why. I wanted to know what Grauerholz himself thought about it. Grauerholz and I spoke in the lush backyard of Burroughs' former home, where he lived for the final 15 years of his life, and which is still held by his estate. I had visited Burroughs himself here in 1995. The orgone accumulator has since been moved into storage. But the backyard now features an urban vegetable garden, tended by the house's current occupant, restaurateur Tom King, who served us a wonderful dinner after the interview. I first asked Grauerholz about the William Tell incident, and he proceeded to expand upon his essay. First, he pointed out that there is a pattern that echoes through Burroughs' early relationships, an MO, as it were, one of making extreme displays to win a relationship, followed by the urge to escape from it. In 1940, in New York City, a young Burroughs pursues a man named Jack Anderson, gets into a relationship with him, and ends up so emotionally fraught that he cuts off the top digit of his left little finger with poultry shears to impress Jack. A short time later, Burroughs and Anderson are living together in what would appear to be the answered prayer to Burroughs' desire. But very quickly, Burroughs sours on the arrangement, leaves New York, and returns to St. Louis under the pretext of illness. Fast forward 10 years. Burroughs is living in Mexico City with his wife Joan and their son, while at the same time desperately pursuing an unrequited relationship with Lewis Marker, a young American student. Burroughs convinces Marker to accompany him on an extended expedition to South America. On September 6, 1951, just days after returning to Mexico City, they find themselves in a small apartment with Joan, Marker's childhood friend Eddie Woods, and other expatriates, where a drunken party ensues. As we all know, this tense psychodrama culminates not in a minor amputation, but in a drunken Burroughs attempting to shoot a glass that Joan has balanced on top of her head. The shot misses the glass, hits Joan in the temple, and kills her. About 6 months later, in the spring of 1952, Burroughs is now living with Marker, again the apparent fulfillment of his desire, but not for long. Burroughs becomes uncomfortable, and Marker soon leaves Mexico and returns to the U.S. as Grauerholz explains.
Well, my point is that just as with Jack Anderson, there was not a death, but the death of his finger.
Yes.
And then they were roommates, and then Lynn got sick of it and didn't know how to end it and get rid of the guy. Right. Pretty much kind of the same thing happened with Marker. Because after he gets out of Lecumberri prison,
yes,
he's back in his 210 or Estapa, and Marker's rooming with him. For
yes.
Weeks and months,
yes.
And making soup and
yes.
Changing, you know, he's sick, he's got, what is he up? I forget. Yeah.
Too,
I mean, so it's the same thing. I mean, their friendship turns into...
Grauerholz described the tense psychodrama among the four people. Marker could not hint at any queer relationship between him and Burroughs in front of his friend Woods. Joan knows this. Burroughs knows that she knows, and while Joan doesn't reveal it, she baits and provokes him.
Yeah, right, Edwin Wood. And I theorized that this was the first time William had seen Barker since they parted just days before, like 4 days before, 5 days, in South America. And of course, there's Marker with his childhood best friend, so no queer angle, no innuendo, no.
Right.
You know, Marker was a straight guy who, like a lot of straight guys, didn't mind having a bit of fun. But the point was, this was his childhood friend, a year younger than he, I think. And so I think what you have to picture is William there in front of his wife, Joan, who, needled him.
Right.
And as well as I can reconstruct it from all those conversations, he was boasting about how, oh yeah, it's Barker, you know, Lewis and I found this place upriver that you go there and you can't get out for 6 months until the river runs right. And I'll be able to get off jump there because I won't be able to get it. And Joan, somebody said, what do you live on? He says, well, I'll shoot, you know, wild game. And Joan, apparently, look at the sources yourselves if you wonder why I said it. Apparently said, oh, with your aim, we'll starve to death. And he apparently said, why don't we show the boys what kind of a shot old Bill is.
Right.
So, I mean, she was needling Joan, and in front of whom?
Marker.
The most wounded pride.
Right.
You know.
Right.
You always hurt the one you love. You know why? Because you know where they are.
Right.
And you get to them.
Right.
So, anyway, so she was needling him, evidently, and he dared her to reenact the William Tell trick or whatever. And I think one of the accounts even said, well, we don't have an apple. I think Marker, who was really drunk when Ted Morgan interviewed him based on the
tape. Right, you mentioned that. Right.
Well, the tapes exist. Anybody can listen to this find for yourself.
Right.
Actually, Ted even mentioned it, maybe, in his book. Apparently, she said something like, well, we don't have an apple, this will have to do, and placed the glass on her own head and posed for the shot. Mm-hmm. And I'm not trying to exonerate or cop out on behalf of William. But I think that it's a really important part, is that she in effect said, oh, you dare me? Well, I double dare you, and we have an audience.
Mm-hmm.
And it's your boyfriend, and that you and I know he's your boyfriend, but his best friend doesn't know. And all of this is very tense. And so he decides he can do it, and he missed. And it's all fun and games till you blow a hole in somebody's right occipital lobe.
Is this too loud or just right?
Just right.
Okay, good. Grauerholz and I then turn to Dr. Harris's discussion in Chapter 3 of his William Burroughs and the Secret of Fascination and in his introduction to Queer. Grauerholz concurs with Dr. Harris's conclusion that Burroughs enlists the incident of the shooting of Joan and its implication of possession as the overriding motivation surrounding the actual content of Queer and, for that matter, of all his writing from then on. But Grauerholz then went on to address what it was that Burroughs was hiding in plain sight, so to speak, in his legendary introduction to the original 1985 edition, that part of Queer that has perhaps become more famous than the work it introduces, and is taken at face value by readers, writers, and filmmakers to this day. Grauerholz said, and I quote, "I mean, a great deal of William can best be understood by him being insecure and haughty, and actually very threatened by other people, and very like the whole thing is sort of a facade. I suggested that the content of Queer is too revealing, too against Burroughs' protective image of himself. But to Grauerholz, it is even more than that. He said that the text wallows in a masochistic portrayal of a pathetic, contemptible, or appallingly weak character. I offered that Burroughs' introduction was perhaps a way of putting a protective shell over a text that has none. And Grauerholz emphatically agreed. The second artifact I chose to explore with Grauerholz in Burroughsland is this three-page manuscript, hand-typed and corrected by Burroughs during the mid to late 1980s. The passages were edited out of what later became Tornado Alley, as I briefly referred to in my presentation last year. In a letter from Grauerholz to Charles and Pamela Plymell, the publishers of Tornado Alley, he mentions that these pages were intended for a memoir that Burroughs was working on. I asked Grauerholz about these never-yet-published pages, their status as actual memories, and the background and fate of the larger memoir that Burroughs had apparently been planning to write. The first page appears to have been an individual anecdote in itself. Here is Grauerholz reciting and commenting on it.
Yes, in the golden days there were still purple patches. I remember Charlie Van Sutherland, Grant, a St. Louis reprobate, and he was charming, charming. I didn't think he was so charming. The last time I saw him on the university streetcar, he burped all the way from Skinker to King's Highway, which is the whole length of Forest Park. He raised an eyebrow and she returned to reading, "If Winter Comes."
Yes.
Special points for the viewers who, before we Google it, can identify that work of fiction. So, we're trying to get him married to this rich widow, and she is pointing out the heirlooms in her apartment, the picture taken with her last husband and General Pershing. And every time she pointed out heirlooms, Charlie threw it out the window. Finally, he'd got a whole cabinet full of memorabilia. Another time, we had all been celebrating rather copiously, and Charlie had the jitters. I got a dry out, boys. So we take him to the sanitarium and sign him in, and he says, "Come back and get him in 3 days." All right, so we come back, and he leans out the window and says, "Chase, boys." And we thought he meant go away. What he meant was he was signed in under the name of Chase. Some patches. Now that would appear to be an actual memory.
Mm-hmm.
Charlie Van Sutherland Grant does not ring a bell, but it clearly is a World War I generation, you know. Obviously, it morphs into Colonel Greenfield Sanders. Charlie Sutherland's a St. Louis Society name. It could be.
Mm-hmm.
Grauerholz and I were both reminded of a real-life character from Burroughs' early life, the syphilis-afflicted father of Kells Elvins, his childhood friend and very early literary collaborator. Grauerholz went on to define the term that brackets this little anecdote, purple patches, as follows. Quote, "Purple in this context means like purple prose, overwritten, florid, too many adjectives, too many cliches, and just matchings, like rosy-fingered dawn. And I mean, that's Homer's cliche, but it has a pedigree of cliches. But yeah, purple patches," unquote. The other two pages are to be seen as a second individual episode. Grauerholz believes the main character villain is an archetypal composite of several real figures from Burroughs' early life, one who appears in his published writings. Here is Grauerholz reciting and commenting on this episode.
Colonel Greenfield was one of the most obnoxious bores of St. Louis. He had repertoires of interminable stories, most of which pivoted on ethnic considerations. He was also a homophobe. Quote, "It was in Paris during the war, a cold rainy night when I was approached by one of those creatures. It was cold and the rain was pouring down. He, or rather it, had no top coat and his jacket was soaked through. So I led him to believe that his importunities were acceptable to me and led him to the door of my apartment, which was on the ground floor. Then I opened the door so he could feel the warmth inside. It was cold and the rain was turning to sleet. Then I knocked him into the gutter and slammed the door." Someone replies, "Ah, well, a bit extreme, don't you think?" Later reply, "He glared at me and I hoped he would suffer a stroke." All right. Colonel Greenfield is a fictional name that you find in mostly in work written after 1967 until the sort of mid-70s. I would say that the Colonel Greenfield is a fictional character, not only by name, but the, but I'd say he's a composite of, I haven't thought about this stuff in so long, Graham Ears Monsell, and not Dr. Senthony. Who was this stuff back in Paris during the war? Well, it actually World War One. It could have been Dr. Senthony, because he, by all accounts, was just a complete prick.
Well, that's a real person you're talking about.
Yes. She's the, he's the one whose wife took a look at him and says, he looks like a walking corpse.
Right, and it's not everyone's corpse that can walk. Yours can.
There you go. It's a winning line, isn't it? I think this is an exaggerated version of an encounter that William did have in St. Louis. If any son of mine turned queer, I'd kill him with my own hand. And this is obviously a continuum.
Yes, yes.
I didn't waste time. I had received expert instructions for dealing with his type in my Boy Scout child molester classes. Stiff fingers to the larynx and a knee to the garage. Having reduced the monster to impotence, I deftly severed his jugular vein with my scalpel. Three times I dragged the cadaver around the block behind my red bud. He liked the Volkswagen.
Oh, okay.
He molested me, I sobbed to a kindly police sergeant, and the mayor himself presented me with the Red Cross for bravery.
Yes.
Well, obviously, that's just one of his ex post facto historical rectifications.
Right.
To go back and make it how it should have been.
As to the status of the larger memoir that Burroughs may have intended to write, the short answer is that what we have that comes closest to this is the posthumously published Last Words, the final journals of William S. Burroughs. But Grauerholz also fleshed out a picture of Burroughs's later life routines, writerly habits, and states of mind. Among his revelations are that Burroughs was influenced and inspired by Tennessee Williams's memoirs, published in the 1970s. Grauerholz told me that Burroughs asked himself, "What is memoir? What is autobiography?" and read a few. As Grauerholz said, and I quote, "For example, he got Tennessee Williams' memoirs, which is definitely a rent payer. William held this up as an aesthetic technique of telling things all out of order just as they came to him. Well, William thought that this was a very evolved and sophisticated technique for a couple of reasons, which overlapped the reasons that Tennessee used it for. First of all, it was the easiest way. And secondly, it appealed to William." Grauerholz confirmed that Burroughs' writing habits were chaotic.
Yeah, he wrote it. He was starting to write memoir notes. Well, they didn't differ substantially from the kind of notes that he was turning
right.
down every day.
Right.
And that note-making process morphed into the raw materials for my education, and in his latter years, into the handwritten.
Right.
And that was, of course, because of the brilliant idea of Jim McCrary was give him a notebook. Because he'd get the pages and then they were loose and then they weren't necessarily numbered and you'd read to the end and like, where's the next piece?
Mm-hmm.
So having to write in a notebook kept the pages together. But he got around it. We bought him a few, you know, to have a choice. So he would write in one and then the other.
Well, in this short presentation, I have sought to distill for you merely a few of the remarkable insights that emerged from my 80-plus minute interview with Grauerholz in Burroughsland. I was frankly astounded by the depth and breadth of his knowledge of Burroughs' life, his heritage, and the settings in which he created his singular, timeless art. Perhaps even more impressive was Grauerholz' recall of myriad small yet revealing details and his ability to riff extemporaneously on these, spinning still more intricate interweavings. I'm grateful to him for generously sharing his insights and to the extraordinary life and work of William S. Burroughs. Thank you all very much.